Hachette Audio presents The Mission of a Lifetime, Lessons from the Men Who Went to the Moon. Written by Basil Hero. Read by Dan Woren. In memory of my mother and father, Angela and Byron, and to those who hold my heart, my loving wife, Marianne, and my precious daughters, Lexi and Ariane. Preface. Finding the Eagles. Cable news networks are once again broadcasting the live countdowns of rocket launches, this time of the privately built rockets of billionaire visionaries such as Jeff Bezos and Elon Musk. Their plans for colonizing the Moon and Mars are making regular headlines, and a new generation raised on movies like Gravity and The Martian has gotten the bug for space. In 2017, 18,300 people applied to NASA for 14 available astronaut slots, all of them hopeful that they might one day run their gloved fingers over the surface of another world. How extraordinary to think that with all the technological progress of the last 50 years, no country today has a rocket powerful enough to achieve the 6 Apollo moon landings that took place between 1969 and 1972. No human has left low Earth orbit or kicked up any moon dust since then. That's a long time. What, I wondered, do the 12 of the remaining 24 Apollo astronauts who either orbited or walked on the moon think about all of this? Not just about the state of today's space program and its future, but more intriguingly, the life lessons they learned from humanity's ultimate road trip of exploration. While their lunar missions have been written about exhaustively, including their autobiographies, those were written years ago and stopped short of probing the more primal questions each of us has wrestled with. It's possible, I thought, that as they were closing in on their 90s, they might be willing, even keen perhaps, to offer the kind of life reflections generated by the accumulated wisdom of their emeritus years. Reflections about courage, about conquering one's fears, about what constitutes a worthwhile personal and professional life, about the latest information on our home planet's perilous state, and their thoughts on the bold plans of innovators like Jeff Bezos to colonize the universe. I decided to make it my mission to hear what they had to say. The men who went to the moon remain history's most elite fraternity. Their extraterrestrial view of Earth from the moon changed them and the world. As of this writing, only 12 of the 24 lunar voyagers are alive. Time was running out to talk to them. The bigger challenge I faced was how to reach them. The improbable answer came on the night of October 29, 2014, with the arrival of Hurricane Sandy, which mutated into a monster that meteorologists needed a new name to describe. They called it Frankenstorm. Lower Manhattan was deluged by a 14-foot wall of surging ocean water and went dark. In Connecticut, where I lived, uprooted trees and downed power lines cut the electricity to my Westport home. My immediate concern was for my retired neighbor who moved next door to me the week before. I was unaware that he was one of the nation's leading space historians. When I knocked on his door to check on him, I could see right away that he needed more than candlelight to safely navigate his living room, so I returned with a few spare storm lanterns. The room lit up to reveal the lair of a rider. The center of Bill's living room was dominated by an 8-foot-long table covered with multiple rows of neatly labeled manila file folders, arrayed against open books loaded with sticky notes. Clipped newspaper articles were scattered near his computer, and bookcases gobbled up the rest of the room. Above his small, round, wooden dining table hung a corkboard with a single sheet of bold lettering, spelling out, "We are the space race." "Are you the same Bill Burroughs," I asked him, "who wrote This New Ocean, the story of the first space age?" His big smile said yes. My new neighbor was a Pulitzer Prize finalist, former New York Times reporter, retired professor of journalism at NYU, and the author of 12 books, most on space and national security issues. Bill and I would share our passion for the moonshots as he worked on his newest book, The Asteroid Threat, which was published 2 years after we met. Bill, now 81, became more than a friend as he began advising me in this undertaking to give readers a prescription for living boldly and deeper reflection from the men who went to the moon. The ex-journalist in me kicked in to start tracking down the men I've come to call the Eagles. Bill, of course, was the obvious starting point, but the only contact information he had was for shuttle astronaut Tom Jones, TJ, who wrote Skywalking and gave a dust jacket testimonial for the asteroid threat. But even TJ had no email addresses for the Eagles, which I soon discovered are known only to a select few who essentially serve as their gatekeepers. So, who are the gatekeepers? I wondered. TJ suggested going to Andy Turnage, the executive director of the Association of Space Explorers, ASE, to whom he made an introduction. I knew I had one shot with Andy and condensed my email to him into a few compelling paragraphs about the theme of the book and gave him a short list of the Eagles I wanted to interview first, among them Apollo 8's Bill Anders, who took the celebrated Earthrise photo, which gave humanity its first clear look at Earth from the moon, and ultimately helped launch the environmental movement. Within the hour, Andy responded to my note. I had passed the first test. He liked what he read and said he would forward my book proposal to Bill Anders and Charlie Duke, the 10th man to walk on the moon. He did not, however, have contact info for the others I had requested. My query hit its mark faster than I expected. That same day, I received the following response. Dear Mr. Hero, I'm Dr. Ditta DeLeiser, archivist and project manager for General and Mrs. Anders. As you can see, your message found its way to me. I'd be pleased to learn more about your project and plans. If you'd like to speak by phone rather than email, I'm sure we can set that up. Best, Ditta. Dr. DeLeiser's note triggered a deep breath of festive relief. But ahead, I knew, lay the make or break part. While Anders was intrigued by my email, he understandably wanted his gatekeeper to start vetting me. Anders, my research showed, is a versatile maverick, a bit of a rebel with a scintillating intelligence, and the only astronaut to figure out how to beat one of NASA's intelligence tests. He has a gift for reducing complex issues to their binary essence and has little tolerance for anything less than excellence. Warren Buffett told me that every move Bill Anders made was smart when he was CEO of General Dynamics, and it was the reason he gave Anders his board proxy in what is considered one of the great corporate turnarounds in modern business history. Anders deals in facts and due diligence. Dr. DeLeiser's job was to find out if I was worth talking to. My job was to convince her that I was. Google searches can give you the facts of a person, but rarely a sense of who they are. Before getting on the phone with Dr. DeLeiser, I wanted to know more about her. She is an assistant professor in the Department of Geography and the Environment at California State University, Fullerton. She is not your typical academic. As I read through her faculty bio section, it was this eye-catching notation under her list of research interests that told me I was dealing with a creative thinker. How women pilots in the late 1920s and early 1930s used their practices of flying to advance feminism in the post-suffrage era. I could see why Anders picked her to organize the history of his life. In a disquieting aside, she recounted the deceptive lengths people have engaged in over the years to get autographs from the Apollo astronauts, including bogus letters from adults pretending to be children dying of cancer, and other sympathy-grabbing devices to get the astronauts' attention and signatures. I had no idea how bad it was. Obsessive autograph seekers and stalkers have driven the Eagles, the Moonwalkers in particular, to closely guard their home addresses and email information. People want a piece of them, Dr. DeLeiser told me. Anything to be able to say they shook the hand or got the autograph of an astronaut who went to the moon. Dr. DeLeiser liked the fresh approach I was taking with the Eagles and asked for my resume, along with a 2-page summary of the book to present to General Anders. I sent it off and hoped I would clear the final hurdle. To my everlasting gratitude, Anders gave me the opportunity to interview him and invited me to his elegant home overlooking Burroughs Bay in Anacortes, Washington. I have interviewed presidents and many other powerful figures at length, but I have never prepared more thoroughly than I did for Anders. When I arrived at the gate, he greeted me in his gardening clothes and semi-joked, as we walked to the house, that he's preparing handicap ramps for the inevitable day when walking will become difficult for him and his wife. Anders, at 85, is nowhere near that point. What struck me first were his blue eyes, which still have the vigor, watchfulness, and intensity of the ex-fighter pilot in him. In fact, he says, he's never really gotten out of the cockpit. Like the rest of his lunar brethren who rode the Saturn V, the mightiest rocket ever built, the need for adrenaline-pumping adventure still beats strongly in his octogenarian heart. He sniffs at the idea of playing golf. Not surprisingly, Anders, who is still thin like all the Eagles, says his daily exercise routine is to fly at least 1 hour a day in one of the vintage World War II planes his wealth has afforded him. Flying keeps him young. Similar eclectic tastes in history kicked off our conversation, and we moved quickly to the real-time impact his lunar voyage had on his notion of man's place in the universe, the anatomy of courage, and the existence of God. Fully engaged by our talk, he invited me to dinner with two close friends. But before heading out, he couldn't resist having a little fun with me. In his study is his prized collection of meteorites and fossils. "You know," he said, "geologists say you can sometimes tell the origin of a rock by tasting it." I was sensing a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.